things that I have a passionate belief in within the context of church is empowering and raising up leadership. One of the ways this is going to happen is through the community small groups that are rolling out this summer. And Nate's been taking a leading role in organizing those. We're working together on it. And I'm telling you, you will be blessed and you will grow deeper in your faith by not just connecting with others, but also growing together in the Word. One of the things along with that, in terms of empowering leadership, is that I believe in kind of the, you know, kick people in the nest and see what happens. And so I asked Nate, hey, want to preach? And he teaches sixth graders at First Baptist Christian Academy. And so, of course, he said, well, yeah, because you guys are going to be better behaved than sixth graders, I have to think. I know we do a little bit of a call and response when I preach. Be a little nicer. But he tells us sixth graders, so I don't think it's going to be an issue. But I am excited, you know, to hear how God's going to speak through it. And for me, I'm going to be selfish for a second. It's nice to be able to sit back and hear someone else preach. And so, you know, we've seen this with Drew. God has spoken through you, and God's going to speak through Nate now. And so we're excited about that. We're excited about what God's going to do through this. And so what we're going to do is a word of prayer, and then bring it. Does that sound good? Yeah. Okay. Father, we are so grateful for this opportunity to open our hearts and minds and hear from your word. And we pray for our brother Nate that you would speak powerfully through him. Lord, that you would be absolutely visible, that he would become invisible, that our day-to-day issues, our problems, our challenges, anything that hinders us from hearing the word, Lord, you would just help us to set that aside and just hear clearly from you. For Nate to speak powerfully through him as we unpack Romans 12, just draw hearts to yours, conform us to your will, to your sin, and be glorified in Jesus' name. And all God's going to say. Amen. 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 All right, you.
I want to thank Pastor Chris and Pastor Rusty for this opportunity. Thank you, B-Side, for at least listening at the beginning. I don't know if you'll be listening at the end, but this is going to be the experience. Oh, good. At least that works. All right, we're going to be reading through Romans 12, 1 through 8. My topic today was to be on community. Pastor Chris just announced the desire to start small groups in the fall. Small groups I've been a part of in several churches, and I believe they're vital, they're important, whatever other vocabulary you want to throw in there, they're essential to what we're doing as we grow together, grow forward, moving forward towards Christ, towards serving Him, towards loving Him more. It's hard to do that on an island, right? So like if you guys were stranded on an island by yourself, it's kind of hard to grow deeper without interaction with other people, and yet we go through life a lot of times trying to be on an island. And so we're going to be diving into that today with Romans chapter 12. We're going to read it first, and then I will dive into explaining. All right, I'm reading out of the NIV in my Bible. I can't remember if this is your NIV up there, but if you'd like to follow along, actually I should probably read it up there because then I won't know when I click it up. I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. In prophecy, in proportion to our faith, if in service, in our serving, the one who teaches, in his teaching, the one who exhorts, in his exhortation, the one who contributes, in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, and the one who does acts of mercy with And we're going to start with Romans chapter 12, verse 1. And the question you ought to ask if you read any section of Scripture is, if you see a therefore, what is the word therefore? Therefore, why is it put there? And if you actually read Romans chapters 1 through 11, you find that the word therefore, chapter 12, is referencing all that has come before it. Now, this is a letter. Romans is a letter. And these numbers and verses, verse numbers that we see in the Bible, they weren't there originally. If they would have received this letter back in those days, they would have read it top to bottom, cover to cover. They would have read the whole thing. And so therefore, it would make more sense to the reader if they read through chapters 1 through 11 than it is to chapter 12. The question I ask, you know, anybody who reads it therefore is, have you read the proper amount of scripture to understand what the therefore is there for? And a lot of times the answer is no. So a lot of us read the therefore and say, okay, he's referencing to the past. But what in the past part of the letter is he referencing? And I think the word mercies is actually our cue. Okay? The mercies mentioned in the first 11 chapters. What are these mercies? And I've listed, this is not an exhaustive list, but I've actually listed several of the main mercies that God goes through in Romans chapters 1 through 9 up on the screen here. Romans 1, God has wrath against the godless and the wicked. Amen? A lot of us are like, oh, you know, like, we got to deal with evil in this world. But God deals with a lot of the evil. Praise the Lord that he deals with a lot of it. Romans chapter 3, the righteousness given through faith in Jesus. We don't have to work for it. We don't have to be a part of the community of the Israelites. We don't have to enter into the country, the people of Israel. We have it through faith. In Romans chapter 5, the gift of the Spirit given to those who faith. We have the Holy Spirit dwelling within us. If you would have asked somebody in the Old Testament, a regular Joe from Israel, he's like, what was it like to see God by fire and by cloud? And I think their question to you would be, what would it be like to have the Holy Spirit living within you, guiding you and directing you? We have been given a great gift of the Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 6, our master is no longer the law, but grace. We are under the good favor of God. Chapter 8, there's no more condemnation in those for those who are in Christ Jesus. That's a big one for me, right? When I sin, what's the first thing I want to do is condemn myself, say I'm not worthy, I'm not supposed to be here, I'm not supposed to be doing this or this. And Romans chapter 8, verse 1 says there's no condemnation for those in Christ. Romans chapter 9, there's mercy from God, not by our effort, but by chosen. You know, God chooses those whom he's going to save. And if you have not heard that before, you know, go read Romans chapters 1 through 11 and read in the chapters 9, 10, 11. Talk specifically about God's sovereignty and choice of who he's going to save and who he doesn't. And that's a difficult, difficult teaching. When I was in Bible college, we spent hours upon hours talking about, you know, did we choose God or did God choose us? A difficult thing to struggle through, but if you have faith in Jesus and the Holy Spirit's dwelling within you, is that going to hurt your faith or is it going to help your faith to go through those struggles of talking about it? It should help your faith, right? But some of us get into those topics and we walk away distraught, we walk away unable to have greater faith, and the question becomes, do you really understand the mercies of God? Do you really understand his word? And again, this list is not allowing of all that's going on in the first 11 chapters. Chapter 1 talks about that God has wrath against the godless. Chapter 2 talks about God withholds judgment against those who deserve wrath. So it's both. God sometimes brings wrath and judgment on those who deserve it, and sometimes he withholds it. And everybody in this room is thankful that he withholds judgment sometimes. Because if he didn't withhold judgment on us, we would be separated from him in eternity. So God has withheld judgment on some that we might be saved. And so we're thankful for that. We're also thankful that sometimes God judges awful wickedness, evil that's in this world, and that he does it rightfully, justly. So the mercies of God allow Paul to appeal in what follows. I appeal is a strong urging. This is the strongest language you can use in the letters, like I appeal, I urge, I exhort, I want you to, what follows, be a result of what has come before. The mercies of God. The Apostle Paul is using strong language to bring about what's about to come. So he is asking you, he's actually not commanding you. The Apostle Paul, through the Holy Spirit, is not commanding what comes next. But he wants it desperately, and he wants it desperately for you because of what God's done for you. And so what follows is something that we should desire and we should be convicted to do. And what comes following? Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercies, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. He He is urging, he is desirous that you would offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. And so, the question is, a living sacrifice, it's a spiritual act of worship. If we read it in verse, the end of verse 1, it says, this is your spiritual act of worship. So the physical sacrifices you make is a spiritual response to God. And so when you actually read the word worship in the Bible, worship, the main definition is to lay prostrate, so to bow down to something. And so when you read about a man going to Jesus and worshiping him, he would be falling at his feet and worshiping and giving him honor and praise. And actually, in some of the translations, they actually say he fell at his feet and worshiped to make sure you understood that the man was bowing down. That is a total submission of being humble and being willing to say, you are way above me. In the same way, this is your spiritual act of worship. When you sacrifice in the body, you are spiritually bowing down to the Lord. I think in the United States, a lot of times, a lot of churches, we teach that, if you can sacrifice, it's okay, it's good. Like, good job, you did that. But, like, we need to really have this idea that any sacrifice we make is a huge deal. Because what does God say about it? Look at middle of verse 1. Holy and pleasing to God. It's holy, it's set apart. The word holy means set apart. It is different than what other people are doing. Like if you're a non-believer and you're sacrificing of your body, it's not the same thing. Holy, it's set apart. What you do on a spiritual response to God, physical response to God, it's set apart in God's eyes and it's pleasing. He likes it. He likes it when you sacrifice of your time, your talents, and your treasures. Your time, right? The world is, there's a saying, the world is loud, it's fast, and it's big. And worship in response to our Lord is small, it's quiet, and it's slow. Like how we respond to God, you can't go into your devotion time and take 5 minutes and, bang it out and be done. The Lord says, be still and know that I'm God. Quiet yourself. Make yourself small. Humility. I'm nothing. I am nothing without God. Slowing down and to giving time to the Lord. But holy and pleasing. What you do with your body, what you do with your time, talents, and treasures, is pleasing to the Lord. And I don't think oftentimes we sacrifice as like, it just passes by in our minds like, oh yeah, it's nothing. But to the Lord, it's a big deal that you would do that as a sacrifice. A living sacrifice has a tendency to crawl off the altar. Imagine the Jews taking a lamb or a cow, and they put it on the altar alive, and then they set fire to the altar. What do you think is going to happen? It's like, oh, it's getting warm up here. I'm going to stay here and let the fire cook around me. No, like, if you're a smart sheep, you might jump off of it and run away. In the same way, God doesn't say we're going to offer our bodies as a regular sacrifice. He's saying living sacrifice. You are alive. You are to offer yourself where you are right now as a living sacrifice. And so, like, I think in Christianity, we kind of judge ourselves by days or weeks. Like, oh, I think this week I did pretty good, or today I did pretty well. A living sacrifice is an idea of being continually up on that altar, minute by minute. So like, if you actually look at your day, minute by minute, how often are you sacrificing yourself? You're giving your living sacrifice to the Lord. And I must admit for myself, like if I were to judge an individual day, even a Sunday where I'm preaching right now, I've done prep this morning, my whole day, it's not a living sacrifice. It's very much me putting myself up there 1 minute and getting off of the altar the next minute. And I don't know if that rings a bell with any of you, but like if I look at my week, it's like, it's more about me than anything. And the Lord says to offer your body as a living sacrifice. And thirdly, a living sacrifice is not dead yet, so you should expect, you should assume there's going to be pain and suffering at some point in your sacrifice. Sometimes when we offer up our finances go the wrong way, and it's like, ooh, this is a tight situation. But God owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. He's always able to provide. Or maybe you sacrifice your time and say, man, my schedule is super busy right now. I don't even have another moment for anything. God sees it. Or maybe your talents. You use your talents all over the place. You're giving to the Lord, you're giving to the Lord, and those talents maybe don't take you as far as you want to go. Or maybe those talents don't allow you to be what you want to be. You're a living sacrifice. God has a great, great, great plan for you. Verse 2, do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world. And so like when I read these verses, I hope you can see like there's kind of like a formula going on. So Paul is urging, he's saying therefore, like he's referencing backwards. Hopefully in your own minds you see the truth of what Paul is talking about. And then he says, offer your bodies a living sacrifice. And the next part he's going to is, do not conform to this world. The ruler of this world, in one sense, is Satan. He is out to destroy anything, everything that God loves. He's especially out to destroy Christians in that he wants to make them unuseful. He wants to make you a waste of what God wants to do in your life. His goal is to make you nothing in terms of what you're spiritually sacrificing, what you're physically sacrificing. That's a pretty formidable foe that wants to make you like dirt. Okay? So that is the one who is ruling this world. And so the wisdom of the world, elsewhere in Scripture, says it's foolishness to God. I mean, just think about this world. The world is corrupt. It's hostile to God. It's ignorant. The world tells you you can do what you want to do with your time. You can do what you want to do with your talents. You can do what you want to do with your treasures. The world will tell you that if you sacrifice a little bit, you sacrifice enough. I mean, just go through different teachings in the world. Just you know, write them down. Write down what you see the world is saying. The world right now is saying gay marriage is what? Okay. Worship, in a sense. You see people like celebrating that which God finds deplorable. God says between a man and a woman, if you read Genesis chapters 1 and 2, you see that the original intent, the first marriage was between man and a woman, and God said this was good. And so the world is saying all these things, and then Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, do not conform any longer to this world. The world is telling you, go this direction. God's telling you to go a different direction. And, you know, one of the greatest examples of that is finances, right? Finances is you need to do this, this, and this with your money. You need to spend it this way and that way. And God has a lot to say about money in the New Testament. He has a lot to say. One of the main things is you cannot worship God in money, right? Checking your heart to see if money has taken up residence in your heart as something you worship. The world ought to be dead within believers. We are foreigners in an alien world. This is not our home. That's a spiritual truth that needs to become very real to you in your lives. You know, and the thing about reading the mercies earlier, Romans chapters 1 through 11, when we read those, and that wasn't exhaustive by any means. Did those truths stand out to you as something that like impacts your life? Or did those truths seem like something that you just read off a list as we moved down in the sermon? You know, even when I was writing down, oh yeah, you know, Jesus gives me my salvation by faith. Cool. You know, like, that should be really more impactful than even for me as I was preparing this. You know, so the world has to become this dead thing that we are moving within, we are spiritually alive within, so that we stand out as different from those around us. Because the people around us who don't know Jesus, they are alive in the world's eyes, but we know that they're dead spiritually. So there should be a juxtaposition, there should be a difference between us. And then the third part, transformed by the renewing of your mind. So the word transformation, many of you have heard this metamorpho, process of catapulting into a butterfly. In the scripture it's used when Jesus was transfigured before Peter, James, and John, when he had this amazing appearance that they couldn't even describe in words if you read that passage. So the word transformation is something that's brand new, never seen before, totally different from what it was. And so it's saying transform by the renewing of the mind. So how do we renew the mind? Being impacted by Scripture, setting your minds on things above, not on earthly things, and then prayer. When I hear renewing your mind, I did my Greek, I had to translate a book of the Bible. I translated Philippians in college. And so Philippians talks about having this attitude or mindset, which was in Christ Jesus, who, being the very form of God, did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant. And so that passage, the Christ hymn in Philippians 2, talks about obedience, and it talks about humility. So the renewing of your mind, the two main aspects of that would be obedience and humility from the Philippians passage. Are we renewing our mind in Scripture, in prayer, with the attitudes of Jesus, which were obedience, total obedience to the Father, and humility? Are those two ideas something that we've got in our heads, in our hearts? Notice the impact of being a living sacrifice and renewing your mind and denying the world. God's will becomes testable and approvable. Look at the end of verse 2. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. This good, pleasing, and perfect will. So like when I look at the three things we talked about offering your bodies, we talked about not conforming to the world, we talked about renewing our mind. All of a sudden, the will of the Lord, you know, one of the main things I think many of us struggle in here with is the will of the Lord. When I was growing up, it was a scary thing. The will of God can be scary. What if he calls me to do this? What if he tells me to do that? Or the will of the Lord can be something that's mysterious. I don't know what it is. It's out there. It's not within me, certainly. But look at the impact of living this way, which I would add isn't done overnight. Maybe not even done over a few years. It might take a lifetime or half of a lifetime. But you will be able to test and approve the will of the Lord. The will of the Lord will become testable in some way. I look at it this way. A lot of the will of the Lord is actually revealed already in Scripture. You know, you might not know what you're doing next year, but you know what you're supposed to do today. God has already revealed to you what you're supposed to do with your time, and your talents, and your treasures. And so the will of the Lord is for you to be obedient in every moment. And so, last week when I was in a coffee shop, a guy approached me. He's like, hey, I've been reading my Bible over there. I'm like, yeah, I noticed that in my head because I pray that if God wants me to do something with him, he'd come approach me. He actually came and approached me about doing a Bible study. I wasn't there to do a Bible study, but I saw him reading his Bible. We were in a 2-hour conversation. The will of the Lord became this testable thing in that moment. Like, you know, Lord, I think this is what you're asking me to do. I ask that you would bring him to me. And so it's testable. It's something that as we grow in faith, this mysterious thing happens where we can understand it better. And approval, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So, do we look at the will of the Lord as good, pleasing, and perfect? Because a lot of times, we talk about being a living sacrifice. Living sacrifices get hurt. A lot of us have been hurt by a family. A lot of us have been hurt by churches. But we should expect in a world of fallen people, that there can be some pain and suffering associated with sacrificing of ourselves to become as perfect as we can become followers of Jesus. And so his will is this good, pleasing, and perfect thing even amidst what we go through. And so, actually, the topic I'm talking about today is being a living sacrifice. This was to be on the heels of Pastor Chris announcing small groups. And so Romans 12 became the passage of choice because of what happens actually in the next 5 verses. We're going to actually get into how do we relate to one another. The most interesting thing is Romans chapters 1 through 11 are about theology. How do we understand God? It's Paul's systematic theology thing, a lot of people would say. He goes into many topics and talks about many things that are very hard teachings. And then he gets into Romans 12, which is like his application section starting. And he's transitioning to how do we live in light of the truth that we believe. And so he talks about Romans 12, 1 through 2, about being a living sacrifice, about not conforming. And then his real down-to-earth application is in verse 3, his humility. So like a real down-to-earth moment is, I want you to be humble. I want you to think of yourselves not more highly than you ought to. So verse 3, for by the grace given to me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourselves more highly than you ought to, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith that's been given to you. God wants you to be humble. I think because of what comes next, which is verses 4 and on, because it's talking about how do we relate to each other in the body. One body, many members. One body, 1 Corinthians 12 talks about when one part suffers, every part suffers. So, you know, imagine in this room, if one person is struggling spiritually to the point where you might be walking away from the faith, another person struggling with sin to the point where you're about to destroy your life, the whole body suffers because of that. In John 17, it talks about, you know, Jesus is praying, and he prays that the church would be one as he and the Father are one. And it's one of the most mind-boggling things for me in Scripture. Jesus asked God the Father that we would become one as he is in the Trinity, one. God the Father, God the Son, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That's a, like, how does that happen? How do you get to that oneness? How do you have a church that is so deeply loving of each other and so willing to forgive each other and so willing to meet with one another and so willing to change their own habits to be part of this one collection of people with different backgrounds, different ages, different pasts, different pains, different joys, and become one? And so it's mind-boggling. And then we're here in Romans chapter 12, and I'll read verses 4 and on. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not have the same function, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all of the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion. He actually goes through some gifts. I don't think it's a total collection of gifts, because I think like technology in this day and age is a gift that some people have and some people don't. Actually, when Paul talks elsewhere in Scripture, he uses different words for different gifts. So I don't think this is a total list he's given. But you know, prophesying, he says serving, he says teaching, he says encouraging, he says generosity and leadership. And there could be more. But he wants us to use these gifts within the one body. And so for questions of consideration, do you know the mercies of God? You know, this is a question that intellectually we can say yes. In the Bible, the idea of mind is actually a connection between heart and head. It's not just simply intellectually, yes, I know the truths of God. I can list them for you five bullet points. You know? No, the truth of the Bible, when it talks about mindset and mind in the Bible, it talks about a heart-head connection. Do we have a heart-head connection on that God judges evil? And sometimes he gives grace to those who should be judged. You know, do we understand that the faith that we have is from God and is the faith that gives us access to salvation? So do we actually know, so the word know there is head and heart connection. Do we have head and heart connection to the truths of the Bible? Second thing, are you impacted by God's mercy to the point of being a living sacrifice, denying the world, and taking steps to renew your mind? No matter where I live, I've lived in a lot of places already. Once I find a church, I usually commit, and then I work towards ministry things going on in that church and bringing growth spiritually to the people there. Because, you know, when I look at the mercy of God, all I can do is say, you know, here we go. We need to do this. We need to, because I love the Lord, my God, and because he has impacted my heart to the point where I need to do something. And so are you being impacted to the point where you need to do something? And it's not just once a week. It's not once a year. It's not once a month. It's not once a day. It's like, you know, this morning I prayed, and then I did some Bible study, and then, you know what, I was just thinking about it because it's fun to think about it. It's great. I like thinking about God. You know, are we impacted to the point where our minds are being renewed in Christ Jesus? Third thing, are you humble in how you view yourself? This is actually a tricky one, because if you actually read chapter 12 there, it talks about humility and it talks about the body. You know, there's a lot of false humility going around. Like, oh, I can't hang out with the people of Jesus because I'm not good enough. Well, who determines that? Sounds like you determine that, and you don't know the truth of God very well, because the truth of God says, you know, once you're redeemed, you are His child. A child has a pretty good status back then. You know, they are the heirs to the inheritance. And so, you know, no matter where you are spiritually, to think that you can't interact with the body more, or you're too damaged, or maybe you're on the opposite side. I'm too good for the people of God, or I'm too busy for the people of God, or I'm too this or that. You know, this false sense of humility or this really true pride can get in the way of what we want to do growing together. And when I say we, I hope it's something that's in your heart as well. You know, it's been in my heart since I was in high school, because I went to a church where the community of God was my number one relationship in my community, because I didn't have a lot of friends. I didn't have a lot of the things that I would desire as a teenager, but I did have my church. And so that's been something on my heart ever since I've left the hometown I grew up in. I want to be in a church where the people like to get along with each other, they love each other, they want to be with each other. You know, I think many of you look at me and you're like, oh, he's too young to want to be with me and to hang out with me. That's not true at all. You know, my favorite memory of ministry was a mission trip with four generations of people, 17 people, three different churches involved, 10 days, devotions in the morning, we did breakdown at night, talking about what we saw God do. And it's a memory that I wish I could recreate in the United States, where we would be together. You know, like, I think that's what makes mission trips so great, is because you have sacrificed 24 hours of your days for like 10 or 14 days to be with each other. And it's like, oh, that's, I can't do that here. Let's strive for it. And, you know, last question, are you functioning within the body of Christ fully? And when I use that word fully, are you moving towards the point where you could say, yes, I am functioning in the body of Christ fully? And that's where the small groups that we're starting in September come in. That's where Alpha Group comes in. The things that Pastor Chris, Pastor Rusty are moving towards. It's a slow process. It's a hard process. But we want to be biblical. Right here, this is my last slide. How should we be towards one another? These are actually references to Scripture with the words one another in them. Depending on the translation, it can be a little bit different, but love one another. Show brotherly love to one another. Honor one another. Live in harmony with one another. Instruct one another. Accept one another. Carry each other's burdens. Forgiving each other. Bear with each other. Encourage each other. Build one another up. Offer hospitality one another. So like the practical point of the sermon is like, choose something on the screen right now and do it this week. You know, is there something you can do here? Maybe you haven't forgiven somebody you need to forgive. Maybe you haven't encouraged, maybe you're a person who criticizes. I'm very negative on my own. So like, how can I encourage somebody? How can I build somebody up? How can I offer hospitality, opening up my home? Love. 1 Corinthians 13 tells us how we can love in many different ways. Love is patient, love is kind, it's not rude, it's not envious, it does not rejoice in evil, it rejoices in truth. So like, how can we show love to each other in our body? And if we can start moving in that direction, you know, one of the things I think we all can agree on, if we have the Holy Spirit inside of us, we want to see our church, we want to see the people in this room, be categorized by people outside of this room as people who love one another. Like, if you can't shake your head yes on that one, then you don't understand the gospel. Because the gospel brings together people who shouldn't be together. This culture says, I shouldn't interact with different races, I shouldn't interact with older people, I shouldn't interact with, honestly, as a single guy, I shouldn't even interact with younger people because of what's going on in this world. Because of how twisted things have become. And so this church should be identified out of all the churches in this community. You know, I wanted to be a competition in that way. Like, let's compete with other churches in this community. be a church that loves each other the most. And hopefully we drive them to love each other better as well. Let's be a church that if somebody walks away, we chase after them. And not just the pastors. Let's be a church that the pastors can delegate and empower the people in this room, because everybody in this room has a gift to use according to Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12. Let's use it, and let's use it to the fullest and the best that we can. And so, I've written a couple challenges on your bulletin as well, like read through chapters 1 through 11 and then read chapter 12 again. Like, read about the mercies of God. Read about how God is sovereign over all things. Read about how Romans chapter 1, how this world is going to increase in sinfulness. If you read chapter 1, it talks about how, like, God gives people over to a depraved mind. And so the depraved mind leads to actual, like, sexual perversion, and worse sexual perversion. It's like, when you look at this world today, you see Romans chapter 1 very alive in our society. And so reading through chapters 1 through 11, applying what we see on the screen. And, you know, I think this is a phrase somebody taught me, like, we judge ourselves by our intentions, and we judge other people by their actions. You know, it's not good enough to intend if we do not carry out. So let's be a people of action. God wants to see our feet moving towards each other, towards Him. Let me pray to close this, and then Pastor Chris will carry on the rest of the service. Father God, thank you for this day. Thank you for truth of Romans chapter 12. I love chapter 12, 1 through 2, Father, being a living sacrifice. I pray that we as a people would figure out ways to be sacrificial, figure out ways to love each other. I pray that this scripture would be on their minds and their hearts this week, and that they would carry out something in your name, to your glory, that they might be able to test and prove the will of the Lord. We see that it's good, perfect, and pleasing. We pray all this in your name. Amen.